Hello and welcome to my channel. This video is going to be quite important for all those who have registered for their NISM certification that is related to Mutual Fund Distributors 5A module. Those who are planning to give NISM examination, again you can rely on these videos. What we have planned is that we would be creating 12 videos in this whole playlist of NISM 5A module that is related to your mutual funds exam. When you have registered, you must have got the study material, which would be in PDF format, that is quite lengthy and that consists of 12 chapters. So that 12 chapters we will be covering in 12 separate videos, which would be included in one single playlist, that is of NISM 5A module. So it would be quite easy for you to just watch a video and get the whole understanding of the whole chapter. And at the end, I will also be including 10 MCQs. So that would give you a practical experience of the questions that will be asked to you in your exam. So these 10 MCQs are related to the most relevant and repeated question in previous exams. So again, try to attempt that at the end of the video. It would be quite useful for you. And before that, I would be explaining you the whole chapter, that is chapter 1, investment landscape. If you like the video, do hit the like button and do not forget to subscribe to the channel and keep a track of this playlist, because I'll be uploading more videos related to it. As I already mentioned, there are 12 chapters, so I will be making 12 videos, and then you don't have to study the whole PDF. You can just keep a track of these videos, you can watch the videos, and I assure you that you will be able to clear the exam. Whatever I have covered is almost the whole syllabus I am covering and explaining it to you. So let's start with our first topic, that is why investment. Alright, your chapter will start with why investment. So before that, I think it is necessary that what is investment? So when you are investing your money, that is you are parking your money in a financial asset. Now what could be that financial asset? It could be a mutual fund, it could be shares, it could be that you are buying any property. So you are making investment, it could also be buying gold. So investment could be in any particular financial asset class, but your single motive of investment is that you want to earn profit out of it. So for example, if you are having 10,000 rupees, if you are keeping that in your saving account, you are just earning a little if that would be provided by your saving account. Even if that you are not keeping it in account, you are keeping it in form of cash, you are not earning anything out of that 10,000 rupees. So what you decided that you would be investing that extra 10,000 rupees so that you can earn profit out of it. Now what return percent you want again would be depending on which asset class you have invested. So the mere aim of any investment is to earn profit, is to grow your money. So if you have invested 10,000, for example, you want 15,000 after redeeming it. So 5,000 you want as your profit, that is your target. So whenever you are investing amount, your aim is to earn profit out of it, your aim is to multiply that cash amount, your aim is to park that cash in investment classes so that you can earn good returns. Okay, so that is called investment. Now why investment is necessary? As I already mentioned, the simple way you can say is to earn profit. I'm investing because I want to earn profit, and that profit would help me meet my financial goals. Alright, so here is the link. Why do I need extra money? Why do I need profit out of my investment amount? Why am I taking risk? Because my investment, we know that there could be risk in certain asset classes like shares. There are a lot of risks, so my invested amount can even go in loss. Why I am taking that risk? Because I have certain financial goals which I want to meet, and I want to take risks so that I can earn profit and accumulate that wealth to reach my financial goals. Now we know that with our monthly income, with our salary, we are not able to fulfill all our wishes. So there are certain financial objectives, for example, funding a child education. So maybe you are a parent and you want to fund your child's education, that is higher education, post-graduation degree, that is costing you a lot of amount and you can't bear that out of your salary because that would be disturbing your house budget. Now, that is the reason that you want to accumulate certain wealth, because by the time your child will grow up and would go to pursue higher education, that would be more costly, and you would be having accumulated wealth to fulfill your child's wishes of higher education. So that is one example. There could be other example like cost of marriage of one's son or daughter, not necessarily your children's marriage. You could be planning your own marriage, and you know that marriages are now costing you a lot. So planning about the budget that would be involved in your marriage, buying a vehicle, buying a house, funding your retirement, all these are certain examples of financial objectives. Now, these are certain financial objectives that we are not able to manage with our salary or monthly income that we are getting. We need to make investment. We need to multiply our money by parking them into different asset classes. Now, if that is financial objective, what is financial goal? So, whenever we are trying to certain the amount and the timeline with our financial objective, that is called financial goal. Okay, so this line, again I'm repeating, it could be asked in your multiple choice question that what is financial goal. So whenever any financial objective or any of your objective, if you are attaching like how much money, that is amount that you would be required, what is timeline, that for what the period you want to keep the investment, it could be 3 years, 5 years, after 3 years you want to buy your house, after 5 years you are planning to buy a vehicle. So there need to be a timeline, there need to be amount, that what would be the price of the vehicle which you are thinking of buying. So what would be the price of the property which you intend to buy after 3 years of time. So how much amount will be required. So once you put that amount and timeline to your objective, that becomes a financial goal. And to meet that financial goal, we do investment. So it is easy. You just try to understand it. Next point that you keep in mind, that short-term versus long-term goal. So you can define it as short-term and as long-term goal. Like for now, I am not having any financial goal, but I just save some amount out of my monthly income. For example, I am saving 5,000. Now, I don't want that my 5,000 rupees have the same value and it is not multiplying, it is not adding anything. So what I do, I invest my 5,000 amount in certain mutual fund scheme, which I think is suitable for me, and I don't have to give much time as I have to give in looking after shares and analyzing. So I better decided to park my monthly savings in a mutual fund scheme that I believe is good for me. So that is like short-term goal. I'm not planning for anything, but what I've decided is just multiplying my money. So maybe after 1 year only, I will redeem my money. I will take my money back and I'll use it as per my wish at that period of time. So short-term versus long-term goal you need to identify. But there could be long-term goal, as I said, your children's education, your marriage, buying a house. You may have kept a timeline for that. For example, 3 years, after 5 years, you want to do this. So if that is, this timeline should be 3 years, generally we take. Like if you have invested for more than 3 years, it is called long-term goal, long-term financial investment. If you have invested for say 1 year or less than 3 years, is also considered as short-term goal of yours. So you need to identify what is your financial goal. Is it a short-term goal? Is it a long-term goal? Again, the next point is financial goal, time horizon and inflation. You need to keep these three in mind. When we are talking about financial goal, like we are just taking an idea of present time, right? So for example, that I have to manage my higher education after 2 years of time, alright? So today, the cost of that institution in which I want to pursue my post-graduation, that is 5 lakh rupees. But after 2 years, is it necessary that the course fee would be same as 5 lakh rupees? No, of course not. It may be increased because we know that there is inflation in the market. So with inflation, the value of currency decreases and the prices of commodities and service increases. Keep that in mind. Inflation decreases the value of your money. It increases the prices of commodities and services. So what happened, that the same course, same institution that I'm getting by 5 lakh rupees, after 2 years, it may cost me 7 lakh rupees. Just assuming. So do I need to prepare for that 7 lakh, or should I prepare for this 5 lakh? of course, I need to prepare for the 7 lakh rupees because I have to invest that much of amount. After 2 years, I need to get 7 lakh rupees and not 5 lakh rupees. 5 lakh is present value, 7 lakh is my future value. So if I am investing for a future goal, I need to find out the future value of my investment. So this is what matters, your financial goal. Keep in mind the time horizon and do not forget the inflation. So for example, today if the inflation rate is 4 to 5%, you need to beat the inflation by your investment. So if you have make investment, try to earn return percentage that is higher than inflation. Because if you are earning the same, for example, fixed deposit generally provide you the return percent that is equal to inflation rate. So what would be the benefit? After 1 year, you are getting 4 to 5% interest on your money, but that is equal to inflation. So today at 100 rupees, you are able to buy something. Maybe after 1 year of time, you are giving 104 rupees or 105 rupees to buy the same commodity. So there was inflation of 4% that raised the price. So even if you have parked your 100 rupees and you have made it multiply to 104, what is the difference? You are buying the same amount of commodity. So try to beat the inflation with your investment. Always try to get the return percent that is higher than the prevailing inflation in the market. Now this was all about why investment is necessary. Now let's come to saving or investment. So generally people can get confused between saving and investment. Is it the same thing or what should you do? Should you save? Should you invest? What is necessary? So saving is safety of money. When you are saving, you are trying to keep your money safe. Saving is a good habit, but is it earning you something extra? The answer is no. Saving is a good habit, but save your money to invest your money. That makes more sense, right? If you are saving your money, you are just having the same value of money, which is right there. So if you are saving the money to invest it, you are investing and earning profit out of it. So there are chances that your money is multiplying. So saving is just to your safety of money. It's a good habit to accumulate, but always save to invest your money because investment will make your money earn something, earn profits out of it so that you can achieve your financial goals easily and you can be more independent. So saving is different from investment, as I already mentioned. Saving is safety of money. Investment is parking money to earn profit out of it. Now, factors to evaluate investment. Now, this all applies to mutual fund investment, alright? So we will be talking in that concern also, taking as an example, factors to evaluate investment. So first is safety. Now, when we talk about mutual fund schemes, there are different schemes. We see that it is categorized as equity fund, debt fund, hybrid fund. Why is that? So different mutual fund schemes are having different risk parameters. Equity funds are more riskier. It means they are less safer. Debt funds are having less risk. It means they are more safer. So this is how safety comes into picture. Equity is investing your money in shares of the companies. So that is having higher risk, but there is chances of getting higher returns. Debt fund is government securities, bond, debenture, safer instruments. So there is low risk, you are getting lower returns. So safety is one way you can evaluate your investment. Some people want that they want to invest in such asset classes which are more safer. They don't want to take higher risk. Then there is liquidity. So even when we talk about any mutual fund scheme, for example, opportunities fund, they are having certain exit load. Any mutual fund scheme would be having exit load. Now, exit load is that define you a time period. So as I took, for example, opportunities fund, exit load ranges between 15 days to 1 month. So if you redeem your money before 15 days, for example, you would be paying extra charge, that is your exit charge. You have to keep your money for at least 15 days. Of course, you can redeem, but you will be charged extra for that if you redeem before the time. If you redeem after 15 days, redeeming means selling your mutual fund units and getting the money out of it. So if you redeem after 15 days, that was an example of opportunities fund, you won't be paying any exit load or exit charges. So this is how liquidity matters. Liquidity means selling your mutual fund unit, selling your shares to get your money back. So liquidity, whenever you are trying to make investment, you try to identify how liquid an asset is. So for shares, for mutual funds that are open-ended fund, open-ended funds are more liquid because you can enter and exit from the mutual fund scheme as per your wish. But when we talk about closed-ended fund, you need to be invested for a certain period of time. So that is less liquid as compared to open-ended fund. Okay, as we will move on to further chapters, you will get to know all these concepts very easily. Then there is return. So you also see that different mutual fund schemes, there are return parameters that you can expect on the basis of past performance. So what return can you expect from any particular mutual fund scheme? That is also mentioned. I'm here taking an example of mutual fund. You can evaluate any investment. It could be your shares, it could be your gold, it could be properties. So there are different asset classes where you can make investment and you can analyze on the basis of same parameter. Convenience, again, it becomes more convenient that when you are using website, you are easily buying and selling the fund and the shares. So it becomes more convenience for you. Ticket size and taxability. So also we see that mutual fund provides you economies of scale as an advantage. Economies of scale means all the investors, their money is pooled together and then they are parked into different investment avenues to earn certain percentage to meet their financial objective, that is same. So ticket size here matters. More the invested amount, more is the chance of getting good return. Taxability, again we see there are many funds which provide tax advantage. So there are tax advantage fund, there are equity linked saving schemes, so saving funds, tax advantage fund, all these funds provide you some kind of tax deductions when you are making investment into it. So that's also another factor to make your evaluation. Other than that, there are certain taxes involved even in shares. When you are investing in shares, there are short-term capital gain tax, there is long-term capital gain tax. So you need to evaluate how much would be the cost charge, how much could you earn the profit out of it. So that is called factor. These are the factors to evaluate any investment. Now let's come to asset classes. So basically in your chapter, these are the asset classes mentioned over here. Real estate. Now, real estate is again an asset class where most of the people make the investment to earn good returns, because we know that the property's value, the real estate, land, buildings, all the values increases rapidly. So it could be in physical asset form. Maybe you are buying residential or commercial property that is in physical form. It could also be in financial form nowadays. So there is real estate mutual fund, there is real estate investment trust, infrastructure investment trust, which we also call a REIT, InVIT. So all these are financial assets that try to invest your money in real estate property. So you are directly not able to buy the property, but with your shorter amount of money, with your lesser amount of money, more good to say, so lesser amount of money, if you are able to invest in real estate properties, if you feel that there is potential of growth. So first asset class is real estate. Then there is commodities. Now commodities could be gold, silver, gold funds, commodities, ETFs. So these are generally called commodities. It could be metals. It could also be agricultural commodities like spices and all. They are traded on multi-commodity exchange. Then there is fixed income asset classes, which are the most secure one. It could be fixed deposit, recurring deposit, your endowment plan, money back plan, public provident fund, all these schemes, and then debentures, bonds, debt mutual funds. They try to provide you a fixed income. They provide a guaranteed return. So there is not higher risk. You know that you would be getting this much of return. So you have invested your amount for a certain period of time, and once your time period completes, the policy matures, the deposit can be redeemed, the mutual funds can be, you can redeem that after a certain period of time, and you can get a fixed income, right? So these all are the categories involved in fixed income asset classes. Then there is equity asset class, which is generally shares. So blue chip companies, you can invest in blue chip companies, are those which are more stable and has given a growth prominence in quite longer period of time. They are having more recognition, larger network and branches. overall in the country. So blue chip companies are again highly valued companies. Then there are mid-cap companies, more good to say, small-cap companies, large-cap companies, unlisted companies, foreign stocks, equity mutual fund, exchange-traded index funds. So these are all types of mutual funds. And then all these companies where investment could be made. As I already mentioned, equity is nothing but shares of any company. So when you are buying any equity mutual fund, you can understand that the fund is investing in shares of certain companies that could be blue chip companies, it could be mid cap, small cap, large cap, as I already mentioned. So with the more we will move to the next chapters, we will get to understand about all these. It has been mentioned very clearly. For now, this much is enough. Hybrid fund again is try to make a balance between debt and equity. So some proportion will be invested in equity, that is riskier fund. Some proportion will be invested in debt, that is less riskier. So there is a type of hybrid where you can take a balanced risk, right? And then there is others asset classes which are not so famous in our country, but in other countries these are also an investment option, that is rare coins, art, and all these things. All right. Now let's move to investment risk. So whenever you are making investment, what could be different type of risk involved? So first one is inflation risk. I will not be explaining this again because I have already mentioned what is inflation. In shorter, it was increase in the prices of commodities and services and decrease in value of your currency. So what you are able to buy today with 100 rupees, you won't be able to buy the same thing after 2 years with the same 100 rupees, right? So that is inflation. The prices has been increased and the value has been decreased of your money. So there is inflation prevailing. Inflation you can thus easily understand. This risk is always involved. So you want to earn return percentage that beat the inflation rate at least. Now let's see liquidity risk. Liquidity also we talked in case of mutual funds, there are open-ended, closed-ended funds. Open-end are more liquid, closed-ended are lesser liquid because there is holding period, there is investment period before which you can't redeem your money. In the same way, when you are investing your money in real estate, physical properties, you know that it is not so liquid because once you plan to sell your land, you have to go through a lot of documentation. You would have to look out for the purchaser of that particular land who would be able to buy your property. So that's not more liquid that today you have planned, you have sold and you get the money back. No, it would involve a longer period of time. So this is called liquidity risk. However, if you have invested in shares, which is very liquid shares that most of the people are buying and selling, so there would be lesser risk of this liquidity. Once you plan that you need to sell this share right now because the prices are high, you would be selling the share and you will be getting the money back into your account. So that is more liquid as compared to the buying properties and all in physical form. So this is where the liquidity risk comes into picture. Then there is credit risk. Okay, so this is mostly in the case of bonds and debentures, where what happens that you are investing your money and you have been promised with certain coupon that you will be getting, or what we call in easy terms, you will be getting certain fixed return percent along with your principal invested amount. Now what happens if the company, if that particular corporate who has issued the corporate bonds to you, they are not ready to pay back you the extra amount. They are just paying back you the principal amount that you invested, but they are not giving you any additional return. So that there is credit risk involved. In that case, what happens, this is referred as credit risk, that you have invested because you thought you will be getting return. They said that they would be providing you a fixed return, but they didn't. So there was a credit risk involved. That's why we always say that credit rating we need to check in case of bonds and debentures investment. There are credit ratings, higher rating means you could be more secure and the company won't do anything bad about it. So again, there is market risk. Market risk is like, for example, in stock exchanges, there is trading being done. So there are buyers and sellers. Now, sometimes what happens that these investors who are buying and selling certain shares of the companies, they sometimes overvalue a particular company, they sometimes undervalue a particular company. So you will see that for no reason, one company, their share prices has rise extremely well. So that was because the company has been overvalued by the investors. It has been like people suddenly looking at the news or something, they have this feeling that this company will do a lot better in the future period of time. They don't analyze the business performance of the company or anything, but they just make this prediction and they invest a lot of amount in that particular company. They keep on buying the shares of that particular company, which overvalues the share of that company, and thus the prices rise a lot. So this is called market risk. Once the company will go bankrupt because you didn't look at the company's performance or business performance, you just relied on your own predictions. So once the company will go bankrupt, what happened? There would be huge losses you would incur. All your invested amount, you may be incurring a lot of losses. So there is always market risk involved. Now this sounds all very fearful, but these risks you can always manage with good understanding and knowledge in this particular field. So whenever you are investing in share, whenever you are investing in mutual fund, try to have more and more knowledge so that you can be comfortable. You know what decisions you are taking. You know what fund is good for you. You know which companies would be performing well. So there would be, you are trying to manage the risk, then you can rely on higher returns. But once you are not having any knowledge and you just jump into these sectors, these investments, then of course you can incur losses as well. So then there is interest rate risk. Again, interest rate is quite related to the bonds and debentures. So once the interest rate rises, by the RBI related to banks, the bonds and debentures, the return percentage, they decrease. So it goes hand in hand. Now this is again called interest rate risk. So these are all the investment risks which you keep in mind. There could be question MCQ related to this. Now here comes one calculation. It's very easy. You can easily understand this. It is related to inflation only. We already talked a lot about inflation. So here's the question. How much money would you need after 5 years to buy the goods you can buy with 10,000 today if inflation is assumed at 8% per annum? Alright, so there is 10,000 rupees in your hand, and after 5 years, if the inflation rate is 8% per annum, how much would you be requiring to buy the same good? Now you can use this formula. Here is amount that you are calculating. Principal is how much you are investing, or whatever is the principal amount, like the present value we can say. Take P as present value, take amount as your future value. Alright, so A is your future value, P is your present value. Then in the bracket you have to keep 1 plus R. R is this rate percentage, that is, here in this case it is inflation rate. So R raised to power N. N is your number of years, your time period, whatever it is, so number of years. Just keep the values in the formula. 10,000 is the present value, 1 plus 8% is, when you will be converting this 8%, it will come to 0.08, that is 8 divided by 100. So 1 plus 0.08 raised to the power 5, 5 is 5 years, right? N is representing number of years. So you'll get the value rupees 14,693. So the same good that you can buy today with 10,000 rupees, you will be buying the same good after 5 years of time with 14,693 rupees. So you have to spend 4,693 extra amount after 5 years to buy the same commodity, right? If there is inflation of 8% per annum. So you can get one question like this. You have to quickly answer that in MCQ. This is simple formula. You just have to put and calculate. Now let's come to risk measure and management strategies. So some people just avoid taking risk. Those are the people who are risk averse. They try to go for secured asset classes, like they try to go for fixed deposits, debt mutual funds, government securities. Also they try to keep their money in their saving account because they at anyhow they want to avoid risk, and That is called risk averse people. They always try to avoid the risk. Then there are people who try to take benefit by taking position in this whole risk scenario of some event. So these are people who are ready to take risk and to get higher returns out of the market. Then there is another category who try to diversify the risk. So diversification is very important. When you are having certain amount, you try to diversify it. For example, that you are having a corpus of 50,000 rupees. Now you try to diversify that corpus in 5 companies, right? If you are investing in shares, so don't just invest all that amount in one particular company. Try to analyze 5 companies that you think have a lot of growth potential. And then you try to invest in all those 5 companies, diversify your corpus. Then you will see that if one company is not performing well, other companies might be performing well. So this is called diversification. Also, you keep in mind that you are not investing all the amount in one particular sector. So like you are investing only in banking sector, or you are investing only in power sector, you try to diversify, right? You try to invest your amount in different sectors that are performing well at that period of time, or you think that these are the sectors that are having good growth potential. So I have chose 3 sectors as such, like infrastructure, technology and banking. Now I will be choosing 2 companies from each sector and I'll be diversifying my investment. So that would be a better diversification strategy. Okay, so this one is behavioral biases in investing. So many a time people take wrong decisions. And why are these wrong decisions? You have heard a lot about the risk in share market. There are people who are really fearful because they have lost a lot of their money. So why does this happen, that they are not taking the correct decision? They are not having a good understanding. So here are some behavioral biases which they are caught in. First is availability heuristic. You generally believe what you have experienced, what you have seen. So you will, when you go to invest in one particular company, you have your own experience with it. You know, you don't analyze that company's performance. You don't know much about that company, but because you don't have a good experience with that company, you decided that you want to be investing in that. Now, this is called availability heuristic. Based on your own experience, you are judging a particular investment, right? So investment is different from your experience. Whenever you are making investment, try to make investment on the basis of the growth potential of that particular investment class, growth potential, the business performance, all these things you need to consider. Then there is confirmation bias. Now this is a tricky one. What you do that you decided that you would be investing in shares of State Bank of India, right? For example. Now you are trying to look out for news that would confirm your decision. Now you're trying to see all the positive news related to SBI. So their profits have grown, their revenue is increasing. You are not seeing any negative side of it. Whatever positive news you are filtering, you are just confirming that, yeah, my decision was correct. You are not getting deep into it, right? So that is called confirmation bias, that you are confirming what you have already decided. There is another process. You need to first analyze, then you need to confirm that, yeah, okay, this one is good for investment. Here you are confirming first and then you are analyzing. So what's benefit? Like, firstly you have decided and then you are analyzing. If you have to invest in the same, what's the benefit of analyzing that share? Alright, so this is called confirmation bias. Then there is familiarity bias. So familiarity bias is that it's better that I invest in something I know rather than investing in something I don't have any idea about. So this happens a lot of time, but because this is also a good strategy for some people, but not for all, because you are missing out on opportunities. If you know only one company, you are keep on investing in that particular company only. You don't know that there are other players in the market. So there is lack of knowledge, right? You are familiar with only few options, and you are like people who are familiar with only fixed deposit. So they would be investing in fixed deposit only. They would be parking all their money in fixed deposit. They won't look for mutual fund shares, other investment options. Why? Because they are fearful. They don't want to explore other options. So this is called familiarity bias. Don't get into trap of this. Then there is herd mentality. What most of the people are doing, I'll be doing the same. So I don't have my own mind. Most of the people are saying that I should make an investment in this particular mutual fund scheme. So I don't know whether it is good for me or not. It is more risky or it is having higher risk, or what is the return percent, what is past performance, anything. I haven't analyzed anything. I haven't asked anything. But because most people have invested in this particular scheme, I will be also investing in that same. So this is called herd mentality. You are following a group. You don't have your own mind to decide. Then there is loss aversion. So these are people who always try to avoid the loss so they are secure and safe. Like if they are having their money, they would be keeping that in their saving account or fixed deposit account. So they are very loss averse. They don't want to take risk and explore other opportunities. Overconfidence. Again, there are people who get into this overconfidence. They think that they are having a full knowledge of the market, and then they get into trap of this. Always they do the same, follow the same pattern, and they don't listen and they don't analyze much. They have just decided and overconfidence about their decision. Recency bias is again what you have recently seen. That comes into your picture again and again. So you try to get into trap of this before making an investment decision. Okay, so these are certain behavioral biases which need to be avoided in investment. As per your theoretical concept, you need to know all this thing. And yeah, it is practically also, once you will start investing, you will get through this all emotions and these biases. Then you will realize that how important it is to have knowledge and then get experience. So it is always my advice that whenever you start investing in mutual fund or shares or any such thing that you are not having much knowledge about, you start with a lower amount, right? So whatever you are having, like 1,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees, that won't affect your financial condition. Start with that amount so that you get an idea. Keep investing with smaller amount. Once a time you'll get good knowledge, you'll get good practical experience of investment, then you can try and make larger decisions. So don't directly jump to by investing larger amount. Now comes risk profiling. So whenever we are trying to analyze the risk taking ability of any investor, we need to profile these three things, that is the need to take risk, the ability to take risk, and the willingness to take risk. So how much risk an investor should take at a particular age? So risk profiling depends on various factors, like how many family dependents you are having, what is your monthly income, what is additional sources of income, how would your family be affected if you are investing certain amount and you lose that amount. So you need to, there is a risk profiling involves analysis of your risk taking ability. You are at a younger age, you are not having any dependent. If you are at older age, you are having your children, your wife. So there are a lot of dependents on you. So your risk taking ability will be lesser as compared to that younger people who is not having so much of dependent at that particular time. So risk profiling need to be done. That how much risk you can take, how much ability and willingness you are having to take risk. So ability will also depend on your sources of income. If you are dependent only on one source of income, it becomes more difficult for you to take higher risk by investing your amount. If you are having 4 to 5 sources, additional sources of income, even if you are getting loss in certain, there are additional sources of income you can rely upon. So this is how you need to the ability need to be analyzed in risk profiling. The willingness, again, it comes to people's will, that whether they want to take higher risk, whether they want to take balanced risk, it is totally up to their choice. And mutual funds provide different schemes, different options that is suitable as per your risk profile. Now let's talk about asset allocation. So asset allocation is a process of allocating money across various asset categories in line with a stated objective. So it means allocating your money, allocating your investable money in various asset classes so that your financial objective could be achieved. That is what is asset allocation. There are three types basically. First is strategic asset allocation, second is tactical, and third is dynamic or rebalancing. Now, strategic, what happens, you have invested, have decided certain financial goal. I already mentioned examples of financial goal. Now, with that financial goal in mind, investment will be done, strategies will be made, and asset will be allocated to achieve that financial goal. So already a strategy is decided and asset is being allocated in such a manner so that financial goal could be achieved. Now, tactical asset allocation is that taking advantage of market and focusing on return percent. So taking advantage of market and trying to get maximum profit is what makes tactical asset allocation. In strategy, we have one strategy decided and we are going through it. In tactical, we are going through the market, we are trying to take advantage of the market fluctuations. In dynamic or rebalancing, again we try to rebalance the portfolio as and when required. So dynamic is a combination of strategic plus tactical asset allocation. Okay, so here comes your MCQ time. We have already covered the whole chapter. Now, very quickly, you try to solve all these MCQs. There are 10 questions. Question 1 is, which one of these is not a factor to evaluate investment? Your options are option A, safety, option B, liquidity, option C, return, and option D, reachability. So the correct option is option D, reachability. Question 2, which one of these is not an asset class? Your options are option A, commodities, option B, mutual fund, option C, stock or equity, option D, real estate. And the right answer is option B, mutual fund. Question 3, choose the correct type of asset allocation. Option A, credit, inflation and price, option B, diversification, rebalancing and strategic. Option C, strategic, tactical and dynamic. Option D, heuristic, confirmation and familiarity. So the correct option is option C. Select the one that is not type of investment risk. Option A, cyber risk. Option B, inflation risk. Option C, market risk. Option D, credit risk. The correct option is option A, cyber risk. Which one of the following statement perfectly defines loss aversion? A. The ability to take high risk for profitability. B. A bear market resulting to investor loss. C. One's tendency to prefer avoiding losses. D. One who invests only in equity market. The correct option is option C. One's tendency to prefer avoiding losses. Question 6. What is real rate of return? Option A, return that the investor gets after payment of all expenses. Option B, return that the investor gets after taxes. C, return that the investor gets after adjusting the risk. D, return that the investor gets after adjusting inflation. Correct option is return that the investor gets after adjusting inflation. The purchasing power of currency changes on account of which of the following? Option A, asset allocation. Option B, compound interest. Option C, inflation. Option D, diversification. The correct answer is option C, inflation. What is asset allocation? Asset allocation is keeping certificates of the physical securities in proper places. Option B, allocating the available money to all the securities available. Option C, allocating the right proportion of funds to equity, debt and money market securities. Option D, none of the above. So the correct option is option C. In order to ascertain risk appetite, the following must be evaluated. Option A, the need to take risk. Option B, the ability to take risk. Option C, the willingness. And option D, all of the above. So the correct option is option D. What is diversification? Option A, to diversify the investment amount in periodic manner. Investing across various asset classes to spread the risk of loss. Option C, investing in sector funds generates a way to diversification. Option D, it is an investment style to reduce inflation risk. So the correct option is option B, investing across various asset classes to spread the risk of loss. Thank you for watching. Do show your support and subscribe to the channel. Any problem related to this video, you can put in the comment section. I will reply to your comments. And thanks a lot